Hello guys, this is Akash and welcome to your third Spark tutorial. In this tutorial, we are going to be exploring Spark more on programming side as well as explore a little bit on theoretical side like we did in the last video. So let's get started. To get started, navigate to a choice of your directory after opening up a terminal and just type in PySpark, yeah. And that should open up a browser like it did over here with something like this as your page. And we are going to be creating a new notebook from here, and I'm going to just rename it. And to do that, you just click on the untitled text down there and it should pop up a window where you can type in tutorial one for the programming tutorial one. And yep, so every single time when you're writing a Spark program, you will need to create something known as a Spark context. And what a Spark context is basically an instance of Spark application, which is responsible for configuring the services and establishing an environment to run parallel program so that you can call in build function and it would go and run the programs in a distributed manner. So when you start a Jupyter notebook, Jupyter notebook already establishes a Spark context for you. And so we are not going to be creating a Spark context when we are working with Jupyter notebook because it already establishes Spark context as well as SQL context for you, which we are going to be exploring in future. However, when you're writing a program, make sure that you guys always create a Spark context, because then nobody will be there to create the Spark context for you, and your program will fail if you do not create the Spark context. So it is basically a way to tell computer that, hey, I'm going to be running a Spark program and I want you to start up all my Spark services. And Spark context will do that. So let's get started with the programming, where we are going to be exploring more on how to create RDDs like we talked in the previous tutorial. So RDD is a resilient distributed data set which are stored in a distributive manner across your cluster. So if you have a 5-node and there's this huge list of things that you want to store in your cluster, then RDD will basically distribute that data set evenly depending on the way your input directory is structured and store it. If your input directory is not properly structured, then it may not distribute the data set evenly, and you need to make sure that it is being distributed evenly across the cluster to maximize your efficiency outputs. Don't worry about it if you don't know a lot about these things. We are going to be exploring more in the future. So let's start with a simple program. Suppose we have a list of numbers 4, 5, 6, 7, and we want to convert this into an RDD. To do that, the command that we are going to type in is that RDD is equal to sc.parallelize our list name. You can also do something like, if you want to type in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, a list over here, a list of numbers, is going to be perfectly fine. You can also type in a nested list of numbers, something like, you know, Akash, 1 for a word count or something like that, which we are going to be exploring more complex inputs in future. But let's just create a simple RDD over here. Simple RDD, and let's view it. So this has created a RDD, and if you want to see the type of RDD, then you just type in print type RDD, and that should give you a type RDD. Now, I'm sorry, I just sent program quickly, but if you want to run a program, you could just click on this button, which is run, and this is for stopping the kernel. Now, if your program is not running properly over here, I recommend that you stop a kernel. If it's taking like extraordinary long time that it should not be taking, you could do that. You could restart a kernel to just start from the scratch. If there is like so many variables that you've initialized, the same number of same types of variable like x over here, and then x in another window, and so on and so forth, then you could restart a kernel which will make all the variables go away from Jupyter Notebook's memory. And this is to navigate among cells, cell up, cell down, and you could do that. This is for pasting below the cell like this. This is for copying, and then this is for cutting, and then this is for adding a cell, again cutting, and then this is for saving a notebook, creating a checkpoint. Okay, so how do we explore what is inside this RDD? And to do that, a simple command is print simple rdd.collect. Now, when you call a collect command on RDD, what it does is that it goes to every single worker and it tells worker that, hey, whatever data you have, please send over to the driver, and all the data that is being stored in the cluster amongst worker node will be sent over to the driver, and then driver can view the data which is stored inside the RDD like we are doing over here. We have a list of numbers which are stored inside our simple RDD, and when we collected over that RDD, we ended up with a list of number. This is, by the way, type list. Now, you should never ever ever call a collect function when you are running your Spark program in prediction, because if you have a very large data set in your cluster, suppose there's a 20 node cluster and you have 1 terabyte of memory in each node, and you have 500 gigs of data on all these 20 nodes of cluster, and you call a collect on those 20 node cluster, then all the data will be sent to the master node, which will be a problematic because the master node has only 1 terabyte of memory, and storing a 20 terabyte of memory, or throwing a 10 terabytes of data set to the master is basically going to crash your master node and hence bringing down the cluster. So be very, very careful when you're calling collect over RDD, because it really could crash your master node if it's not being called properly, unless and until you know that the amount of data that you're going to get out of the result, it's going to be very, very, very small. You should not call collect. So what is an alternative? Well, you could call take instead of a collect, and where I'm going to say that, okay, I just need first two elements from this RDD, and that's it. You could print it, and you see that we only get 1 and 2, which are the first two elements of RDD. Now, remember in last video we talked about how Spark was lazily evaluated? Let's explore more on that. So Spark has two type of inbuilt operations. One of them is known as transformation and other is known as action. Let's change this to the markdown. So the difference between action and transformation is that when an action is called, it triggers a computation in Spark. However, when a transformation is called, any computation is not triggered. So for example, take is an action in Spark, whereas parallelize is a transformation. So to prove, if we comment the take action from this command, then you can see that nothing happens. As soon as the program executes, it terminates. Now, by the way, no computation has happened. In sc.parallelize, the program has compiled and that's it, it's over. But as soon as you call an action over here, which is just take the take action, what it does is it takes the first two elements from an RDD and prints it. So when you call an action, it performs some computation and prints you with 1, 2. And this is how Spark is lazily evaluated. When a transformation is being called on RDD, no computation happens. But as soon as an action is called, all of a sudden you have huge computation that starts happening all the way from parallelizing an RDD. Now we are going to explore more on how Spark is lazily validated in future videos, but for now just know that Spark has two types of inbuilt operation. One of them is known as action and other is known as transformation. Now take, collect, etc. are type of action, whereas parallelize is a type of transformation, and transformation does not trigger any computation. Now let's explore on some more type of transformations. Another type of transformation in Spark is known as map. Now what a map function does is that it basically takes every single element that is inside an RDD, in this case it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and applies some sort of computation on that every single element of an RDD and returns your result. So for example, suppose we want to square every single number, we can define a function that defines square, which takes a number as a parameter and returns number into 2, which is a number square. And what you can do is we can map square function on this simple RDD and see what happens. Now for example, if we comment out the action and we execute, nothing happens, no computation has happened at all. But however, as soon as we call an action on this, the computation starts happening, which is squaring every single element. Now to be fair, let's just print entire RDD by saying collect command, which is again an action, and you can see that every single number has been squared, and that is what has returned. Now whenever you call this collect and take action, what RDD does is that it converts it into a list type, because all the data that is present in different partition goes to the driver and it is converted into a simple Python list type. Now let's explore lambda functions. What are lambda functions? Well, it is popularly coming from a lambda calculus, and it is a function that does not have any name. It's called anonymous functions. And why do you want to do that? Well, to make your code more readable, and it's just pretty easy to do. Instead of writing this huge functions over here, by the way, it's not a huge function, it's just a single line function, what you can do is you can say lambda x is, you know, and then just say x square would be a return. So you're mapping that lambda, which takes x as an argument and returns x square as an output of that function. So it returns the same thing which this square function returns. But however, you see how this code is more readable than this function, and that's why you want to have lambda functions. Now there are limitations with what you can do with lambda function and what you cannot. So just whenever you are using lambda function, make sure that you are using it properly. For example, using lambda function, you cannot print any statements. For example, you cannot do, you know, print x. That's not going to happen. It's an invalid syntax. But you can do some sort of action on, some sort of transformation on it. Map, you know, a square or maybe even a cube of that function. And it's going to make your code more readable compared to this thing where you have to go back to this entire function and explore. Another advantage that lambda functions offer is that because you don't have to do a function initialization, you don't have to worry about, you know, miscalling any function or something like that if you're like thousands of functions written above. So it's just basically, you know, one time define an anonymous function, use it, and then let it go. It's more popular in functional programming. And that's pretty much it for this video. So stay tuned. We'll explore more on programming side in next tutorial.